All right, so last week we spoke about historical knowledge and its practical applications. Okay,
excuse me, sir.
Yeah, yes,
sir. Are you giving this recording?
Yeah, I will record it and keep for those who are requesting. I can give it later, just in case. Okay, yeah, just in case if required. All right, so guys, listen this very carefully. Okay, this is very important. Now, when we start this class, we started this class in March, okay? That's basically targeting grade 11. I'm sorry, my laptop is experiencing if you getting stuck. Can you all hear me?
Yes, sir.
A few issues. Okay, all right, okay. So, yeah, I think after the latest update, yeah, sorry about that. So, when we started this class in March, right, we started with grade 10 content, okay? Grade 10 content. You know, the first 7 lessons of grade 10, okay, is so important that many marks, you know, you can score something around 35 to 40 marks using those 7 units only. 35 to 45 marks in your exam, okay? That's almost half of your marks using only these 7 units, guys. So that is why we focused on these units. Now we are in unit number 6. All right, fine. The others who joined lately might be wondering, okay, oh my God, did I miss anything? No, no problem. You guys can come to grade 10, no problem. We will get you covered, okay? So don't worry about it, all right? So the 7 units are so important because of several reasons, okay? One reason I just told you, that there will be questions worth of something around 45 out of 100 covering these 7 units. You know, the Sri Lankan map, okay, the for map marking, you get 9 out of 100, right? For map marking, okay, Sri Lankan map marking, you get 6 out of 100. World map marking, you get 3 out of 100. That is basically 12 out of 200, you know, fractions, right? 6 out of 200. This is for world map marking. 6 out of 200. 12 out of 200 for Sri Lankan map marking. So that will come down to 6 marks out of 100. Okay. So over here, there's that 6 as well. That also comes from those 7 units, the first 7 units. That is why the first 7 units of grade 10 is so important. Whether we covered it or not, yeah, we covered it. Yeah, that's fine. I mean, it's also your duty to go dig deep and make your book your best friend and get this thing done. Okay, so that's on you. And my part, I'm doing from my side. Okay, and the next one is these 7 units, Puta. These 7 units are interconnected. They have a very good relationship between each and every lesson. That is why these 7 units are so important. I mean, let's forget unit number 8 for now, Candy and Kingdom. Let's take it as a separate unit. It's okay to consider that as a separate unit. Okay, it's all separate units only. But I'm telling you, when forming the relationships, okay, so unit number 1 has a direct relationship with unit number 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. They are all interconnected. Okay, so when you understand the relationship between those units, it's easy for you to answer questions. Otherwise, it's going to be tough. Okay, because there will be questions like you might feel like the question belongs to unit number 5, but they actually belong to unit number 6 or unit number 7. Okay, that's crazy. You know, so we need to understand the differences. We need to understand the relationship between those units, so that we can answer many questions much, much better. Okay, so imagine 45 marks out of 100 covering only these 7 units. Let's say you want a C pass. You want a C pass, just go ahead, do 8 units in grade 10. You can get that C pass if you do it perfectly. Okay, you want an A pass? Yeah, just work it out a little bit. 75 marks, right? So it's not a big deal. So that is why these 7 units are so important. Okay, so that is why we started discussing these units first. we gave more weight to these units. In the revision class also, we'll be discussing those units. We'll be starting from grade 10 first lesson and gradually moving towards grade 11 content. Okay, this is what's going to happen in our revision class. So in revision class, normally we will dedicate 1 hour for theory and 1.5 hours for papers, doing papers and discussing those. Okay, so that's how the revision class is going to break down. Okay, so grade 11 content, guys, you know, next week will be a combined class, and the week after that, that is 12th August, we will start grade 11 content in this class. Okay, and grade 10 guys, they can come on Friday morning and we will do grade 10 content.
Sir, morning at which time?
6 to 8. Yeah. Okay. So.
So is the class start from next week?
No, next week this class will continue like this. Same like this. Okay. The week after that. That is 12th August. 12th and 13th. Okay. The class will be split into two. I hope you understood.
Okay, sir.
All right. Next week, because next week we are planning to cover unit number 7 of grade 10. Okay. Unit number 7 we are planning to cover next week. Today we'll try to start it. Okay. All right. We'll give it a try to start it. All right. So let me share you guys the screen. The mind map that I made. I received only a few mind maps, which is sad. I was expecting more mind maps. Okay. But anyway, you guys can practice this.
So I'll send it by today.
Yeah, no problem.
Sir, so, sir, what is a mind map?
Okay, don't worry about it. Okay, we'll discuss that in our grade 10 class. Okay, those who didn't attend, those who don't know what's a mind map, don't worry, we will get you covered. Okay, don't worry about it. I'm gonna share you this. By looking at a mind map, you might feel what it is. Give me a second, guys. Give me a second. I'm just trying to figure out how to turn this PDF. My computer is playing the fool of late. I don't know what's wrong with this thing. Looks like I need to get it formatted or something. Counterclockwise. Yes, I got it. So in a nutshell, okay, in the least possible verb, you know what's the meaning of a nutshell, right? So in the least possible words, this is what I got for unit number 6. All right. Over here, even I got cramped a little bit for space. Can you see this area? So that is why I suggested you guys, you can actually go for an A3 paper, because there's a little more content in this unit. So it can be very nice and You know, I saved my time for decorating this. But you guys can go ahead, take your own time and do some decorations so that these things get highlighted. Okay. As you can see, this is the main topic we are talking about. So this is a mind map. This is the main topic we are talking about here. Historical knowledge and its practical application. This is what we are talking about. So when you make a mind map, be very precise and, you know, do it in the shortest way possible using minimum words. Okay, this is what we recommend when you do a mind map. Mind map is like a key to your brain, key to your memory, that you remember all these things. And whenever there's an exam, you know, this is like a screenshot. Okay, you remember this like a screenshot. Okay, so around the main topic, I have organized all the subtopics. As you can see, these are all subtopics of the unit. Okay, so after the around the subtopics, I have broken it down to further subtopics like this wherever required. Okay, over here I thought no need for subtopics, so I just went into content directly. Over here I thought there's no need for subtopics, so just I wrote 3 bullet points like this. Here there's like 4 bullet points. Here there's 3 more bullet points, as you guys can see. Okay, so that day we discussed about social organization and how these things worked. And let me just, you know, take a few minutes to repeat it again. We know that, you know, the social organization or the officers in the ancient times were appointed based on their knowledge and their ability. Okay. So the king was at the top. King was also regarded as Eshwara, like God. Okay. King was like God to the people. The king, some kings, you know, they presented themselves as gods. So then the ministers, army generals, or the leaders of the army, and treasurers here, ministers, generals, and treasurers, they shared the same level of power, similar power. Okay, they were at the same level. Then the clergy, not below the ministers, but the religious leaders, or we call them clergy, especially Buddhist religious leaders, because Buddhism was the prominent religion here in the country. So Buddhist religious leaders, or chief monks, enjoyed a lot of power. I mean, because they were like advisors to the king. Whenever the king wanted advice, the king went and met those religious leaders and took advice from them. Whenever the king had to make any major decision or something like that. Okay. Then the chieftains are basically doctors, teachers, merchants, and also here I have not mentioned, but you can just imagine that naval captains, okay? Right, those who owned ships and those who basically commanded ships. Especially when they were doing foreign trade, okay? So those people had big respect in the society. They are called chieftains, okay? Leaders of the society. Then under them, the general public like farmers, potters, fishermen, blacksmiths, people like that, were considered general public. Okay, so this is how the society was organized in the ancient time. Okay, and then some important words to note. Raddala is used to call the elites or the aristocrats, those who worked very closely to the king. Okay, those who were very close to the king, they were called Raddala. Okay, and there's another word, Anvayata Dasa. Those are, Dasa means slaves. Dasaya kiyala kiyanne, that's normally a singular word used to call slaves. So Anvayata Dasa means slaves who came from lineage. That means father is a slave, the son is also a slave. His son also will become a slave like that. Okay. Another word called Kudin. Kudin is used to call general public. Okay. So let's continue from there. This is what we discussed that day. And little bit of law and tradition. Yes, I'm going to touch on that once again. There were 3 main taxes charged under law and tradition. You know, tax law was very important. Not like today, taxes were charged properly those days. Huh? Today, the taxes are not charged properly. You know, many people evade taxes, right? That is why the country is facing economic problems. Yeah. Those days, the taxes were charged very systematically. Okay. It was systematic. Everything was done properly. If you didn't pay taxes, the fines or the punishments were also given properly. So there were three types of taxes. Dakapati, Bhojagapati and Mataramajiva. Okay. Three main taxes. Dakapati means a tax charged for the use of tank water. If you are using tank water for agriculture or some other activity, mainly agriculture, right? You had to pay a tax called Dakapati. That tax was called Dakapati. Okay. Bhojagapati means Bhoja. Bhoja means like you know there's a single word called Paribhojane. Paribhojane ke liye kya hai? You use it. So Bhojagapati means use of lands. Lands are normally considered to belong to the kings. Okay. Lands are king's property. The whole country belonged to the king. Those days, it was considered like that. Okay. Lands, the king is the owner of the lands, like that. So Bhojagapati means if somebody wants to use king's lands for cultivation, you have to pay a special tax. That was called Bhojagapati. Okay. Mataramajibaka means Mataramajibaka. Means when you catch fish in waterways, you had to pay a special tax for catching fish in waterways. Okay. That's called Mataramajibaka. Matara. You know, today we like use the word matsya. Matsya ke lagyanne fish. So you can see the relationship between matara and matsya, right? Okay. Then when it comes to inscriptions, several inscriptions are very important. You have to remember these names. Kondavattavan inscription. Kondavattavan inscription. This mentioned about fines for not plowing on time. Okay, if you don't till the land properly on time, you have to pay a fine. Okay, if you till it early or if you till it late, you have to pay a fine. Vessagiriya inscription mentions about the types of grains you can cultivate on paddy field. Okay, it was a very tough rule. You can't cultivate anything you want in the paddy fields. Okay, there is a law for that. There was a law for that. You can cultivate only certain types of grains in paddy field. You know why? Why do you think? Okay, tell me. Okay, this is a question. Why did they bring a law like this? Now, always ask the question why when you are learning history, okay? Because this is not like, you know, like parrots. Like you just by heart everything or cut apart. This is not how you learn history, okay? You always, you know, use your head. Ask the question why? Why do you think there was a tax like this? Sorry, there was a law like this in inscription, Vessagiri inscription. Why?
Because you should maintain the economy of the country.
Maintain the economy. Uh-huh. Any other answers? Mm-hmm. That's a good answer.
For the protection of the society.
Sorry? Give me a little scientific answer. These days we have this, you know, Pohora issue and everything going on, right? Are you guys watching news? So give me a little science-based answer. Yeah, please think and give me. Why did they not allow? Okay, I will agree with that Puta's answer. To maintain the economy, yes, you can think of that way as well, because you know. When there's no enough paddy, the country's economy will suffer, right? So people, let's say you want to cultivate paddy and you earn this much, but if you cultivate something else, you earn more than that. So people will cultivate that item, right? I mean, let's say mungata. If people can earn more money by cultivating mung or green gram, they will do that, right? Without cultivating paddy, then the economy might suffer. Yeah, that's a good answer. But let's go a little scientific here. Let's think like scientists.
can't grow like can only grow paddy in those areas.
Okay. Give me. Let's go a little deep. What do you think? Anybody? Anyone else? Any other answers?
To get sufficient rice or paddy for food.
Okay. Yeah, that's what we discussed, you know, by talking about economy. Okay, we need sufficient paddy. We need proper production, right, to feed the people, to maintain the economy.
Sir, I think that king is telling to do like that to keep the soil fertilized.
Very good. Very good. Well done. That's a scientific answer because, you know, certain types of soils are better suited for certain types of crops. Okay. So when, let's say, when you change the crops, the soil, the nutrients or the vitamins or the minerals in the soil might, you know, get diminished, might change the chemical composition. Like we say in science, it might change and then it might not be suitable for paddy cultivation again. You never know. So people had the idea. People knew, people might not have known about agriculture, science or something like that those days. But this is what we are talking here. This word, practical. Okay. They were so practical. They knew by experience. Maybe they didn't go to university, okay? They didn't have universities. They didn't have Google. They didn't have Wikipedia. They didn't have chemistry knowledge or anything like that. But they knew what to be done, like when to be done and how to do this. That's why we named this unit practical application. See the relationship between practical application and this. See, okay? So this is something that I'm just taking you one step further, okay? So like think, okay? We are talking practically here. So, all right. So then let's go to the next one. Mihintale. Mihintale inscription. Another important inscription. It mentioned that death sentence should be given to those who are killing buffaloes. Okay? If you kill a buffalo, you will be hanged or you will be beheaded, you will be killed. That's the punishment at a certain time. Okay. And another inscription called Vevalkatti inscription. This mentioned a lot of things about criminal law. Now, this is so special. Okay. Vevalkatti inscription. Because it gives you a lot of knowledge about the ancient criminal law. Okay. Criminal law. So, what type of punishments are given to people? And if a village failed to produce a criminal, the whole village had to pay a fine. Okay. So, those things are mentioned in Vevalkatti inscription. Right. So, that is why Vevalkatti inscription is so important. And also, you know, when there was a, like, when you, let's say, one guy stole cattle, harakhoru kiyala kiyanne api. Okay, so those days also there were, you know, cattle thieves. Okay, so if you steal a cat, if you steal a cow, okay, that cow's, you know, there's a marking in the cow, right? The owner's name or whatever it is, like, there's a marking normally put in the cow. So that same mark will be put in your forehead. In Sinhala is called hangwadu gahan. Okay, like you know, everybody sees it like it's like a tattoo. Okay, everybody sees him, they know, okay, he is a cattle thief. Okay, he was caught for stealing cattle and then he was given this punishment. Okay. So everything is mentioned in Vevalkatti inscription. Okay. So I want to tell you this word, special word. There's no space to write it here. Gruhadanda. Gruhadanda, go to page number 82. You see this word under Vevalkatti inscription. Okay, look at it leisurely, right? I'm going to write it here. Ruhadand. Now, this is the punishment given to people when they fail to produce a criminal to the authorities. Okay. Let's say maybe the villagers knew that the criminal is inside their village. Maybe they didn't know. Whatever it is, their responsibility, you know, the king gave the responsibility to the villagers to catch those thieves and produce to the authorities. Okay. So if that didn't happen, they had to pay a tax until they could produce the criminal to the authorities. That fine was called Ruhadand, like a tax. Okay. It's like a fine, like a tax. Yeah. So people also had a big responsibility in that. Okay. So one very important inscription when it comes to trade-related laws, business law in Sri Lanka, okay, is ancient business law we are talking about. Sorobora Vava inscription. Sorobora Vava inscription. Over here you can see that. It's called Sorobora Vava inscription. It is also called Badulla inscription. Okay, this one. So go to page number 81 and 82. You see 5 points, 5 laws that is written in Sorobora Vava inscription when it comes to the business related or trade related laws in Sri Lanka. Okay, I have written 3 here because I expect you to remember 3. You can write whatever you like here. Okay, go to page number 81 and see. Right, so don't copy this note. In your book, you try to make your own mind map like this, like I did, but use this as a guidance, okay? Because I have included everything, all the important things here. Then you will understand how to read the book and how to basically form the relationship between you and the book. When you have this relationship, no? In the exam, you see the book, right? You close your eyes, you see the book. You see whatever is written in the book. That is how you answer. Because, you know, you answer with a smile, you know, when you see the question. Yeah, you immediately smile. Why? Because you know from which unit it's coming and you know how you studied this unit. When you studied this unit, how did you take your notes? Everything you will remember in the exam. Okay, this is how playing smart. Sir, yeah.
Sir, are you giving a note or should we make a note?
This is the note for unit number 6. For some units, I will be giving you tutes. Okay. This unit is not very long. So this note is more than enough for this unit. But let me tell you one thing. You guys need to read the unit in full. Okay. I can't do that for you, but it is a must. You must read the unit in full. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
And let's go to finance and exchange. Okay, finance and exchange. How finance was handled? How exchange was taking place? I didn't write a lot under this unit. Okay, I thought these things are important. So you have to remember. The oldest coins in Sri Lanka were called Has Ebu. Or Kahapana, Kahavanu, Kahapana, all are same. Okay, Has Ebu coins. Then this officer is very important. Rupa Adhyaksha means officer in charge of molding coins.
Sir, can I have the old mind maps also?
Yeah, Puta, can you just keep your questions later, please? Let me finish explaining this, okay?
Okay, sir.
All right, keep your questions. I will give you time to ask questions. Okay. All right. So, oldest coins were called Has Ebu or Kahapana. And Rupa Adhyaksha is a special officer. Was a special officer appointed by the government, who's basically in charge of molding coins. Okay. You know, Adhyaksha is called the director. You know, you guys remember we learned a word adheka, asa adheka, hati adheka. Do you remember that? Yeah. Which unit? Rohit, you tell me.
Third unit.
Third unit, yeah. So, asa adhyaka hati adhyaka adhyaka means the adhyaksha coming from that word, okay? Adhyaka became adhyaksha. Adhyaka means again director. Adhyaksha is director. Today also adhyaksha is director. So rupa, rupa, you know, rupial also we can imagine that's coming from that. Okay. So rupa adhyaksha means officer in charge of molding coins. There was a special officer who's in charge of molding coins. Okay. Kalanda. This word is very important. Kalanda is a unit to measure weight. Okay. Kalanda is a unit that was used to measure weight. So apart from this, there were foreign coins which were used in Sri Lanka as well. They found many coins related to China, you know, Roman coins, Chinese coins, and coins like VOC, like the Dutch coins, you know, those were all used in Sri Lanka. Okay. I mean, after the ancient times, right? The ancient times, mostly Hassebuo Kahapana were used. So Kalanda is a unit mainly, you know, used to measure gold, metal, precious metal like gold. Okay. So metal, to weigh the metal and according to that, you know, to do business was might have been a practice those days. Okay, that's about finance and exchange. So let's talk about women, the role of women in the ancient society. Look, normally in Sri Lanka, in the Sri Lankan society, women were considered, women were not oppressed or they were not suppressed. Okay, women also enjoyed kind of equal rights like men. Okay, so some good examples are Queen Leelavati coming to power 3 times. Okay. There were several queens who ruled the country. Okay. Queens. And also Parumakalu was used to call female Parumakas. You know that Parumakas were basically like regional kings or regional chieftains or regional leaders. Okay. Parumaka. Mapurumuka means the king. Mahaparumaka means the king. So Parumaka means like ministers, like regional rulers. Okay. So Parumakalu is the female version of Parumaka. Okay. And there's another word here called Madhupachika. This was used to call women who are experts in cooking. Cooking was an art, right? So Madhupachika was the name used to call those women who basically chefs, like, you know, experts in cookery. Okay. And in the ancient society, women were eligible to marry when they turn 16. When they are 16 years old, they were eligible to marry. Okay. If you ask your grandmothers, maybe grandmother's grandmother, if your grandmother is alive, ask her about her grandmother. Okay. Yeah. Go and ask. Okay. Maybe, okay, you ask your mother about her grandmother. Okay. Maybe they got married when they are so young. Yeah, maybe 14, maybe 16, 15, 17. I remember my grandmother, she got married, I think, when she was like 15 or something, I think. Yeah. I don't know. I don't remember exactly. Maybe 15 or 16. Yeah. So if you see the ancient society, maybe 12, 13, 14, like that, you know. You know why? Why do you think? Again, the question, why? Yeah, we need to know, right? I mean, just learning something for the sake of it doesn't help, right? We need to know why.
So to increase the population?
Not to increase the population.
To increase...
No. I'm talking about eligibility for marriage. It's not like, you know, you want to push somebody. You when the girl is growing, like, you want to push her to a marriage and you want to settle her. It's not like that. I mean, they were ready. Okay. We are talking about readiness. They were ready to start a family life when they are 16. You know why? Because the society, the needs and everything were not so complex like it's today. Today we have education issues. You know, everybody needs to get educated, needs to have a permanent income, needs to build a house and that and this, and need to have a phone. How many needs do we have? They're so complex today. Today's society is so complex. Ancient society was so simple. Okay. So let's say, for example, when a child turns 10, he knows how to do his father's job. Okay. By 10 years old, 10, 12 years old, he knows everything basically. How to cultivate a paddy field. How to build a house, everything he would know by 12 years old. Now, today is not like that. Today, the society is very complex. Today, people are not ready. Today, if you see men and women, they are both not ready until they turn at least 25 years old. Not ready to marry. Not ready for a challenge, for a family life. Because they want to study, they want to earn money, they want to save money, they want to do a lot of things. Ancient society was so simple. Okay, let's say father is doing agriculture, son is also doing agriculture. Daughter will also know everything about agriculture, about cooking and everything. By that's all you need. Society was so simple. Okay, so that is why they were eligible to marry. They are eligible, or they were ready basically to marry in a young age. Okay, so if you go to ancient times, like ancient, very ancient times, maybe 12 years, 13 years, like that. Some queens, you know, got married when they are 12 years old. Go back in history and see. Because they were ready. Because they basically, the society was so simple. The needs are so simple. Okay. So, there was a special place given to mothers. Mothers were treated with special respect. Okay. In the ancient times. That is a place that was given to women in the ancient society of Sri Lanka. Okay. Ancient society. Yeah. When it comes to the modern society, this is not enough. I think the way we treat women now is not like we used to treat them before. I saw this when I went to work in the United Arab Emirates. Okay. So in UAE, in Dubai, I went to a visa. You know, I went to renew my visa. Then I went to get a visa for my wife. Yeah. Renewing of my visa is done through my company. So when I went to the visa office, okay, you know, this is where I started comparing, you know, the role of women in Sri Lanka and like in other countries. Okay. So there was this counter. Okay. Counter one, counter two. There were many counters like this. Okay. There was a special counter. This counter said pregnant women. So no need to stay in the queue. They have a special counter. Pregnant women and pregnant women and I think women with children. Yeah, I remember something like this. If you like, let's say if a pregnant woman enters, all the queues will be cancelled and she will be given priority. That is how, you know, okay, I like to see that treatment here in Sri Lanka, because we had such treatment in the ancient times. Okay. If you like, see the way they treat. Okay, right. So we are talking about equal rights. Yeah, that's a good thing. But I mean, pregnant women can't stand in a queue. Okay. We are talking about equal rights, but pregnant women or mothers with little children should not stand in a queue for hours and hours. That's what I believe. They need to have special treatment. They need to be given special treatment. Okay. So I like that, you know, I like that standard in Sri Lanka as well. We had that before. Okay. This is what it says, right? I mean, women were treated with special respect, who were mothers, especially mothers were treated with very special respect. Today we have it. I mean, it can, I mean, when we see the number of incidents, number of abusers, number of issues that the women are facing in the country, you know, I'm a little disappointed, you know, to be honest with you guys, because women should be treated better, because, you know, like in the ancient times, we have treated them very, very well. Okay. That's something to think about. Okay. All right. So let's go to local food. There are a lot of names of food in the book. Okay. We can't list all of them here. Right. There are, like, if you count them, there are like 60, 70 names in that section. Kind of crazy. So over here, I took a few very important points. That's pala malua and kadi ambula. That is considered the food of the poor. Okay. Pala malua and kadi ambula. You know, for any curry, normally they use the word malua. Okay. Malua. Malu means, today we call it fish. No? Malua kila ken polos malua. Malu miris malua. You can make a malua. Malua means basically a curry. Okay. So pala means what? Pala means leaves. Okay. Kadi ambula. Those are the food of the poor. Okay. Then this is so important, guys. Kanda or gruel. There are different types of kanda. Okay. Lunu kanda. Many types of kandas were there. Kanda means gruel. You know kanda, right? Yeah. We can call it porridge as well. Porridge. Yeah, in English, you can call it porridge as well. Kanda. Today, we like to eat gotukola kanda and everything, right? So, kanda is very popular among all the people in our country. Okay. It's like a part of our food style. But today it has gone away from us. No? We are mostly eating this malu pan and sini sambal pan and everything in the morning. Right? This is not good. That is why we have health problems. Ancient times, they drank mostly kanda in the morning. Okay. So, again, that trend is coming. Like, many people are selling kanda and everything now. Kola kanda. Yes. Which is a good thing, right? This is how the ancient people lived a very healthy lifestyle. Okay, right. Then there's another word, tila sangulika. Sangulika means like guli. So that's basically sesame rolls or thalaguli. Thalaguli. And peacock meat cooked in ghee. This was the food of the chieftain. Those who had money, those who were wealthy, they used to eat peacock meat. One of the favorite dishes of the chieftains. Okay. Any questions up to this? We'll go to the last part of explaining this unit. And then let's discuss a few past paper questions. There are different types of kandas. Okay, go to page number 88 and see them. Lunu kanda, Diye kanda, Ulu kanda. So different types of kanda, especially for patients to get back on feet, like to restore their energy and everything. Kanda is considered even today one of the most energetic foods. Okay. Yeah, kanda. So in Europe, you know, they eat cereals. They're very equal to kanda. Okay, very similar to kanda cereals. Yeah. All right. So let's go to the environment. Now, how conscious these people were about the environment? How conscious the ancient people about the environment? That's a very important thing to know. Okay. There's a plate inscription in Anuradhapura, which said that you cannot cut forests. You cannot cut trees in the forest, especially in the hilly areas. Why do you think that happened? Why do you think they imposed such a rule? You can't cut trees in the hilly areas.
Because of the soil erosion.
Soil erosion, because basically it will contribute to earth slips, right? Earth slips, yeah. That is why they said not to cut landslides. We call it earth slides, earth slips. Yeah, soil erosion. That is why they said not to cut any trees on highlands. That is there in Anuradhapura plate inscription. And Buddhannehela, there's an inscription found in Buddhannehela near Anuradhapura, okay? That's again said that no trees in forests should be cut. So they knew the conservation of forests, how important they are for the balance of the ecosystem. Okay. They knew it. They knew the consequences of cutting forests. If they didn't know, they would never bring a rule like this. Okay. So we can understand that they knew how to practically apply their knowledge. Okay. Then the another inscription called Kondavattavan inscription. Over here also it's mentioned. This was talking about fines for not plowing on time. But here, this inscription also gives information about government officers, you know, having to manage the woods and the tree. Wood means the forests and trees. Okay. They have to manage the forests. Let's say if somebody wants to clear a part of the forest for maybe chain of cultivation or anything, government officers have to decide whether to allow it or not. Okay. So that's about the environment. Okay. So I want you guys to take like a few minutes and check this out. And if you have done your mind map already, compare this with what you have done. And if you have not done it, no problem. You can just read it and try to remember what you can remember from this. Take a few minutes for this before we go into past paper questions. In the meantime, if you have any questions, please ask. Any questions, guys, from the mind map? Newcomers, are you guys okay with everything?
Sir, I am okay.
Good, thank you. Amandi, are you okay too?
Yes, sir.
Akit, you okay with that? Akit, you were absent last week, no?
Yes, I'm okay.
Malaysia, did you restore your connection? You had a connection problem? Manupa, you okay?
Sir? Sir?
Yeah. Yeah?
Sir, can I get the previous mind maps?
Previous mind maps. I'll give you. I have notes also. Just a few tips. I will upload them, okay? I'm just waiting until the others join the group. So I'll be uploading them as well. I'll upload the tips again.
Thank you, sir.
Tihan and Vetum, all okay there? Tihan, are you having any connection issues?
No, sir, no. No?
Bihandu, what happened to your phone? Is everything okay
now? Okay, sir.
Good. Any questions, guys? No? I'm going to show you the past papers now. Who's ready for this? 2016, guys. Can you see how important this unit is? There are two questions straight away I noticed, but maybe there are more from this unit. Okay, let's see. Can you see question number 15 from this unit? Question number 15, MCQ.
Yes, sir.
All right. So, which of the following queens ruled this country 3 times as mentioned in history? Now, this answer is also in unit number 7, okay? This one. Leelavati Queen, Leelavati Rajina. Leelavati Queen, Queen Leelavati is the answer here. So, this also, it's also mentioned in unit number 7. So, sir, it's okay. Anyway, I will take it as unit number 6. Sorry?
So, can I know the name of this past paper?
This is 2016, Bhuta.
Oh, thanks.
Okay, let me share the past papers again in the group, okay? I shared it like once, but not in the new group. I will share it. So,
sir,
here, go to question number 18. Go to question number 18. Here, do you see this word? Is it familiar?
Attacks.
Yeah. Is it familiar? Yes. This one. Dakapati. Is it familiar? Have you seen this before? Many of you, yes. I mean, I'm asking especially the new joiners. Yeah. Here. See? Dakapati. So, what's the answer?
Word attacks.
Water attacks, yes. For using tank water, so water attacks. Yes. I'm going to go to another paper, 2017.
Sir, what is the notes?
I can't hear you. What is it, Buddha?
Sir, what is the good you are for putting the notes?
Are you part of that group yet? No, I will add you to that group. Okay, no worry.
Group only.
No, not the revision group. No, there's a special group. Okay, I will add you to that.
Okay,
remind me. Okay, yeah. Okay, can you go to this? Can you see this screen?
Yes, 20. Sir.
Yes. Check 20. This is from this unit. Check the question number 20. Now, the challenge is when you see the question number, you should know from which unit it's coming from. That's the challenge, okay? If you can understand, if you can guess from which unit this question is coming, that means you are very good in your memory and you have formed the relationship between you and the book. Okay? When you see the question, you must understand it's coming from unit number 5 or unit number 6 or unit number 7. This will take a little time, but again, when you study properly, it's easy.
Sir, yeah. How will that question number?
Which one to the question number?
Sir, you said that you that can tell the from which lesson the question come from the question number?
Not the number, from the question itself. Not the number. Okay. When you read the question, right? When you read the question, see, hiding criminal in the ancient society. So when you read the question, you must know from which unit this is coming. Yeah. So what's the answer? Rovind, you tell me the answer here.
Second.
All the villages, right? Otherwise, they had to pay a tax. Okay. What was that tax called?
Gruhadanda.
Gruhadanda. Yeah. Gruhadanda. Very good. Let's do some more questions. I will show you some more questions, okay, from other papers. This is 2018. I'm looking at unit number 6 only. I don't immediately see anything here from number 6. Anyway, I want you guys to answer this question. Here. Can somebody answer this question? And tell me why.
Fourth answer.
Mm-hmm. Why?
Because after the main harvesting periods, there must be enough water for the last harvest.
Exactly, yeah. So, there were three harvests of cultivation. Yalakanne, Mahakanne and Madakanne. Oh, Yala season, Maha season and the mid season, or intermediate season. Okay, so intermediate season is an additional season. Where they decided to harvest, that is the third season, okay? Where they decided to cultivate, if there is enough water, if there's a possibility of receiving enough water, they decided to cultivate an additional harvest. Okay. Let's go to 2019, sorry. Another paper and see. That's a beautiful question. Oops. What's that? Okay. Can you all see the screen? 16 is from this unit.
Yes, sir.
But you have to think a little further here, okay, before you answer this question. 16. Fifteen also from the same unit. Very easy, no? 15 is very easy, right? We just discussed that. Bihandu, tell me the answer to the 15th one, Buddha.
Sir, can you scroll down a bit?
Down?
Yes, sir.
Like this?
Sir, still we can only see the 2018 paper.
Oh, really? Sorry. I thought I'm sharing the right one. Sorry. Okay. Can you see it now?
Yes, sir. Now can see.
Okay. 15 and 16, okay? Coming from unit number 6. We just discussed both of them. 16, you have to think a little further, think a little deep and right. I mean, find the answer.
So for the 15th question, we can get the answer as second one.
Yes, sir. We can get the second one.
Second one. Okay. Any other answers?
Second one, sir.
Second one. Very good. Second one. Exactly. Yeah. Bruhadanda was the name of the tax. Okay. So getting a tax, that the tax name was Bruhadanda, from the villages where the criminal lived until they seized them. Okay. Right. Good.
But the answer for the 16th is the green. 16.
Uh-huh. Okay. Any other answers? Can someone else contribute as well? The main factor led the woman in ancient Sri Lanka to be respected with high regard was the main factor. The main factor. See, look at these words, okay, when you answer a question. Because there will be more than one answer here. Can be. But we are talking about the most suitable answer, okay? So we have to think very carefully. Yeah. Main factor, main thing is the motherhood of a woman that is respected. Because, you know, you can't have this because unmarried women, then they are not respected. They are also respected. But I mean, motherhood is something that, that one of the best things a woman can achieve, right? So, like motherhood or fatherhood for a man, right? That's a unique in the sense, not unique. I mean, it's the highest position, you know, that you can achieve, right? Being a mother is... Being a father is something that, you know, like it's something that will make you to be respected, will get you the respect. So main factor, yeah. Okay. Talents with regard to cooker, you know, you can ignore all this. Okay. Right. Good. Let's go to 2020, and before we start the next lesson, let's see if we can find something from written questions as well. Okay. 2020 paper is not very clear. We haven't got the proper one yet, I think. It's okay. I can't see a direct question. Maybe okay. Let's forget it. No MCQ is found. Okay, I want you to answer this. 2016, paper number 2, question number 1, part 2. Part B and subpart 2. Here, this picture, can you see it?
Yes, sir.
All right, what is this?
Sluice.
This is a sluice, right? Any other answers? If you think this is not a sluice, please tell me. Yeah, it's okay. I mean, I might be wrong, huh? We never know, okay? Yeah, maybe you are right and I'm wrong. Who knows? Maybe I might commit mistakes as well. So you have to correct me, okay? That shows your level. I mean, that's what a good student does, okay? Even if a teacher commits a mistake, he must be able to correct it. That means he is learning properly. We can see that he is learning properly by him being able to correct the teacher's mistakes. Okay. Yeah. Otherwise, if you are not correcting, if I committed a mistake, if you are not correcting it, that means you are not learning. You don't have the knowledge. Okay. Okay. So what is the name of the creation? It's a sluice. What is the task of it? Okay, who can tell me this?
To release water from the tank to canals.
To let the water out of a tank, right? Yeah. Basically, this is a part of a tank. You can use this to let the water out of a tank. Newcomers, don't worry about it, okay? Like, if you have learned in your school, you can try and answer. If not, it's okay. We'll be covering this. Don't worry. In which creation of... This is a little stupid question. You know, see how they have arranged the grammar. In which creation of irrigation work this could be seen? Grammar is all over the place. It's like a, you know, gully Bowser exploding in the middle of a town, you know. In which creation of irrigation work this could be seen? Yeah. What irrigation construction that you can see this in? That's the question here. Yeah, they have put it in words so that nobody can understand this. I don't know.
Building tank system.
Yeah, tank in a tank. Tank is an irrigational creation, right? Tanks, canals, those are all irrigation constructions. Okay, irrigation related to irrigation. Irrigation means basically constructions related to water management. We can call it irrigation. It can be tanks, it can be canals, it can be dams, aqueducts, those things. Okay, irrigation. So tanks. State one type of material used in creating this. Oh, one type of material.
Stones.
Yeah, stones.
Stones.
Yes. Exactly. That's something extra. Okay, over here, can you see this?
Can see, sir.
Okay. Number three, guys. Check this out. We'll do this and go to our new lesson, okay? Officer in charge of making coins. We just learned this.
Rupa Adhika.
Very good, very good. Rupa Adhika, right? Rupa Adhika. Officer in charge of making coins. Rupa Adhyaksha or Rupa Adhika, right? Officer in charge of the horses.
Asha Adhika.
Asha Adhika. Yeah, Asha Adhika. Asha means horses, okay? Officer in charge of trade. Here we go.
Pana
means trade. Okay. Nagara means city. Nata means nata. That means drama. We did a little bit of past papers just to test your understanding of the lesson. Okay. I really believe in doing past papers for practice because they are the proper standard. Okay. Like I know some students, they are getting like 80, 90 for their history in their school exams. But I have seen personally when we look at their O-level results, it's not enough. That is why we need to do, we need to always do papers of similar standard, That is why we do past papers mainly. Okay. So, might be a little boring past papers, but we have to do them because there's 3 hours for you to write, huh? Writing only for 3 hours, guys. And forget that 1 hour. Tactic took, right? 40 questions. Can do that. I mean, that's what we are doing here. I mean, you have to practice, okay? Those questions are also not easy. Some of the questions will take you on a ride. So, end of the day, it's all about practice, practice and confidence. That is why we teach you all these lessons and the relationship between those lessons. Any questions up to now? Shall we start the new lesson? We can complete this lesson next week and start our grade 11 lessons the week after that. Okay. I'll give you the tutorial for this lesson next week, new lesson, okay? Lesson number 7. Decline of ancient cities in the dry zone and origin of new kingdoms in southwest. If this is north, southwest is this. Yeah, this is north. So we are talking about decline of the ancient cities in the dry zone like Anuradhapura and Polonnaruwa, an origin of new kingdoms in this area. Here, this area, okay, of Sri Lanka. As you all know, Anuradhapura is the first kingdom in Sri Lanka, Anuradhapura, then Polonnaruwa. After their fall, many kingdoms emerged in this region, which is the southwestern region in Sri Lanka. Like Dambadeniya, Kurunagala, Gampola, Kandy, Kote, those kingdoms is what we are going to talk about under this unit. We are going to also talk about the decline. Why did Anuradhapura fall? Why did Polonnaruwa fall? And why there was a need for other kingdoms in this region. This is what we are going to talk about under this unit. Okay. And there were other kingdoms as well, especially, you know, there was a kingdom in Jaffna as well, which is considered Jaffna Kingdom, which is called Jaffna Kingdom. Kind of a semi-official kingdom. Okay. There was a ruler, there was a king in Jaffna as well, mostly supporting the other kings in, you know, the other region, like not after Anuradhapura, I mean not during Anuradhapura and Polonnaruwa, but after them, okay, when these kingdoms are in existence. Okay, so in this lesson we are going to learn about all the kingdoms basically in Sri Lanka. Okay, what events led to those kingdoms to be established, why some kingdoms fell, why they changed many locations. We are going to learn about those things in this unit. Very, very important. And also, we are going to learn about significant events that took place during the times of those kingdoms. We are going to form the relationship. Okay? What are the most important events that took place under Gampola Kingdom? Kandyan Kingdom is a separate unit. It's unit number 8. Okay. What is the significant event that took place under Dambadiniya Kingdom, under Kurunagala Kingdom? Yeah. What are the things that took place? So we form the relationship and we find answers to questions. Okay. So let's start with the first kingdom in Sri Lanka. Before that, I'm going to draw a timeline and show you where it stands. Let's say this is the start of Anuradhapura Kingdom. Okay. Anuradhapura Kingdom. Anuradhapura Kingdom existed for a very long period. I think 1300 years or something. Then the Polonnaruwa Kingdom. Okay. This is where we are today. This is, let's say, 1815, the fall of Kandyan Kingdom. This is the invasion of Kalinga Maga in 1215, fall of Polonnaruwa Kingdom. This is Anuradhapura Kingdom. This is Polonnaruwa Kingdom. And these are all other kingdoms. This is what we are going to talk about in this unit. Okay. A little bit of this, Anuradhapura. Little bit of this, Polonnaruwa. And little bit of, not little bit, a little detailed about this new kingdoms in the southwest. Okay. So we should know what we are learning before we learn. Right? So, guys, Anuradhapura kingdom is the first kingdom in Sri Lanka, right? Anuradhapura, before it became a city, it was called Anuradhagama or Anuradhagrama. King Pandukabe is the one who made it a city. He wanted to centralize ruling. So, to do that, you know, he made it a city. He made Anuradhapura a proper city with a proper plan. That is how Anuradhapura kingdom was born. And many kings after him ruled Anuradhapura kingdom. Okay. Very renowned kings like King Dutugamunu, King Mahasen. Yeah, many kings ruled, many very important kings ruled Anuradhapura kingdom without any problem. There were problems from time to time. There were invasions and everything. You know, we managed to defeat those invasions. And somehow, Anuradhapura kingdom survived for many, many years and centuries. Okay. So we can consider Anuradhapura kingdom as the first urbanization. Basically, it's a big city under which the settlement expanded. Okay. So that's
sir.
Yeah.
Excuse me, sir. The Magama city also built in those areas, those time, no, sir.
Magama is also a trade center. Magama was a trade center as well, but it was not a kingdom. Okay. We are talking about kingdoms here, right? So
okay, sir.
That's so basically, yeah. So basically, Anuradhapura was the first kingdom in Sri Lanka. Okay. 1400 years, guys. Something around 1400. Anuradhapura city or Anuradhapura kingdom existed for more than 1400 years. Now, Anuradhapura, the location of Anuradhapura is so important because it's very close to, you know, Mathotta. Mathotta and Anuradhapura. It's very close. So if you see India, let's say if this is India, this part of India, or we can call it the western part of Indian peninsula or Indian subcontinent, was developed at that time when Anuradhapura kingdom was there. Okay. So all the relationships, the trade relationships, the diplomatic relationships, the military relationships, all the relationships were connected to Mathotta Harbor. Mathotta was the main harbor at that time when Anuradhapura kingdom was there. So it's very easy to reach Manna from Anuradhapura. So we can understand that the kings continue to use Anuradhapura as their city because of its close proximity to Mathotta Harbor and also the ease of maintaining relationships with other countries like India. Okay. That is so important. You guys can go to page number 92 and see this sketch, which displays a plan of the ancient Anuradhapura city. As you can see, the city is very properly organized. The temples, the roads, the bridges, you can see them all here. The monasteries, okay. Everything next to the city itself. In page number 93, you can see the arrangement of Polonnaruwa city. Again, you can see that it's very properly managed and properly organized. Everything is in the proper places. Okay. Yeah, just go and see in page number 93. What can you see? Page number 92, you can see a sketch of Anuradhapura city. Page number 93, you can see a sketch of Polonnaruwa city. Okay. It's so important, guys. So, the first urbanization, which is considered Anuradhapura city, you know, after the Chola invasions, this city was abandoned, then Polonnaruwa was chosen as the new city. Now the king who established Polonnaruwa as his capital was King Vijayabahu the Great, or King Vijayabahu I. So there was a need to develop this harbor, which is called Gokarnatitta, Trincomalee harbor. Why? Because, you know, the relationships between this part of India. Now, when the Polonnaruwa kingdom came into existence, this part of India got very developed, and also they used to have a lot of connections between the far eastern countries in Asia, like Burma, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, those countries. Okay. So because of that, because of those connections, there was a need to develop this port, or Gokarna port, Gokarnatitta, both are same, huh? Trincomalee port. So that it's easy for us to maintain relationships with other countries. There's another reason for this. After the 6th century, the Arab traders started coming to Asia and do a lot of business. So the kings saw the need to maintain very good relationship between these countries, between the Far East and Europe. Okay. Arabs were like middlemen. They came from the Middle East to Sri Lanka, to India and Far Eastern countries. They bought spices, they bought gems and everything. They went to Europe and sold them there in that market, or in Arabia or in Europe. Okay. So they were basically ruling or controlling the trade, international trade in the whole region. Okay. So the king saw, okay, look, in order to be able to maintain good relationships with other countries, especially trade relationships, you need to develop this part of the country. So based on that, it's very easy to reach Trincomalee from Polonnaruwa. King Vijayabahu I chose Polonnaruwa as his ruling center. Okay. That is the main reason, right? And also the invasions and destruction of Anuradhapura by Chola invaders and everything. Many, many things played a part. Okay. Many things. But we are talking about the main reason why there was a need to establish a kingdom in Polonnaruwa. Okay. To get the benefits of those transformations that took place in the region. Especially the development of the eastern coast of India and also the relationship between countries like Sri Lanka and Burma or Myanmar. Today is called Myanmar, it's Burma those days, and Thailand and other countries. You know, King Vijayabahu, the first, married a Kalinga princess. You know that? Yeah, we learned it in unit number 3, right? Give me a second. Let me share you something. King Vijayabahu, the first. Why did he marry a Kalinga princess called Tiloka Sundari? Tiloka means what? Three worlds. Sundari means beautiful. So, beauty of the three worlds, right? Maybe because he's so beautiful. Is it? Is that why he married a Kalinga princess? Yeah?
No. For the protection of Sri Lanka by Chola.
Basically, to maintain good relationships with other countries. That's how, that is why he married queens from other countries, okay? Can you all see this map? One second, Buddha. One second.
Yes.
Take questions. One second. Let me explain. All right. So, if you see this map, Kalinga Desha, Kalinga, state of Kalinga was somewhere here. Okay. Can you see this Odisha today? That part. So, as you can see, you know, it made sense for King Vijayabahu I to choose Polonnaruwa as his ruling center because it's very close to Trincomalee and it's easy to maintain relationships with other countries in the region through Trincomalee than Mathotta. Because Mathotta you have to take a long route. Okay. Yeah, it makes sense, right? Makes good sense. And also we had good relationships with Myanmar or Burma, Thailand and Cambodia as well. Can you see Cambodia? Some kings married queens from Cambodia as well. Okay. So all these countries, you know, in the Far East had relationships with our country. Okay. So there was a need to shift the ruling center from Anuradhapura to Polonnaruwa. Okay. So then came the problems. Okay, before that, I think I had a question. Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead. What's the question?
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, King Vijayabahu I married Tiloka Sundari for the protection of Sri Lanka, no, sir?
Look, many reasons, okay, due to many reasons. Normally, if you marry a queen from another country, what happens is mainly the relationship between your country and their country develops, right? So there won't be any invasions. Yeah, you can say it that way, protection. But also the relationship. Okay. Now let's say if King Vijayabahu married her only for protection, people of Kalinga are so stupid that they gave Tiloka Sundari in marriage to King Vijayabahu. Do you think they are so stupid? Yeah. He is looking for protection, so it's okay. We'll give our queen to them. It's not like that. I mean, yeah. There are many reasons. Okay. Maintaining good relationships, basically. So when you have good relationships, I mean, even when there's another enemy coming and trying to attack our country, you know, we can get help from Kalinga and everything. But there's something like this we need to understand. By marrying, you know, queens from other countries, significant immigrations took place from those clans. Okay. This is something we need to understand very well. We are understanding history here. Okay. Forget the syllabus for a moment. You understand the lesson. You understand the motive of teaching this lesson. Okay. Right. Let's say this is Kalinga. So you married a princess from Kalinga, okay? Many people that belong to the princess family also immigrated to Sri Lanka. So there were clans. Okay, same like that Pandyan, there was another kingdom called Pandyan kingdom. Okay, so there were relationships with Pandyan kingdom as well. As a result, Pandyan, I don't remember exactly, Pandyan was somewhere here, I think. Anyway, Pandyan clans also started immigrating to Sri Lanka. Okay, so basically the queen's relatives. All right, queen's relatives. Now when King Vijayabahu the first married Tiloka Sundari, her relatives came from Kalinga, state of Kalinga, to Sri Lanka and settled here. Okay, now after the death of King Vijayabahu, after that there's another king, King Parakramabahu. Everybody basically had connections to these countries. Okay, we have to understand that very, very well. So basically, there were in Polonnaruwa, there were two clans, two groups with two roots. One group is from Kalinga, the Kalinga clan, and another group was Pandyan clan, those who had a relationship to Pandya state. Okay, Vetum, okay, got it. Got the message. So Kalinga state and Pandyan state. Okay. Now, when it comes to choosing the next king and everything, what do you think these two clans or these two groups did? What do you think that happened? Yeah.
They try to bring their caste people to the rule of this country.
Exactly. They try to bring their people to power. That means what? Fighting, problems, internal conflicts. Okay? Internal conflicts started arising for the first time in Sri Lanka when it comes to grabbing power, grabbing royal power. Okay? So as a result, Polonnaruwa, the political situation in Polonnaruwa started deteriorating because of those fights and conflicts, internal problems. Now we can see that when there's an internal problem in any country, it's easy for another country to go and project their power or capture them or basically have influence. Okay. Now let's say, let's take a few examples in the world. You know this country. I'm not saying who's right and wrong here, okay? We just take an example. Okay. You know this country, right? North Korea. Okay. Ruled by a guy called Kim Jong-un, okay? Kim Jong-un. Maybe 35 or 36 years old, right? Authoritarian, okay? These people, they don't have freedom, nothing. Okay? But South Korea is totally different. It's a democratic country. Kim Jong-un is ruling this. He's got a big army and everything, okay? But there are no internal problems. So USA and South Korea, they are always telling like, we will attack you for the past 20, 30, 40 years. They are telling that, but they still can't do it. I'm not saying North Korea is right. Okay. But I'm telling you the power of unity. I'm trying to tell you that. Because it's being able to hold its power because of the unity. There are no internal conflicts. Again, another country. Here, Iran. I'm not saying what Iran is doing is right, okay? Against the international law and everything. That's different, okay? But what I'm trying to say is they don't have internal conflicts. They don't have internal conflicts. That is why nobody is able to invade Iran yet. Still, they are thinking like 10 times before they can attack Iran. Why? Because there's no internal conflict. Okay. But what happened in Syria? Lot of internal conflicts. USA came, Turkey came, Russia came, Iran came. All the other countries came inside and they are fighting, they are supporting their own groups, and it has become a mess. It's like Third World War in Syria, inside one country. All the countries are fighting, they are deploying their own people, their own interests. Very complex situation because of the internal conflict. Okay. So remember that very well. So when Kalinga and Pandya, those two clans clashed with each other. Internal conflicts. Okay. As a result, weak rulers came to power. Right. So there was no proper ruler in Polonnaruwa kingdom. And the power struggle again between Kalinga and Pandyan clans. And when there is a war or when there are issues, the economy is definitely deteriorating because there's no enough attention given to develop the irrigation systems, maintain tanks, nothing. No trade between other countries. Everything is a mess. Okay. So taking advantage of this situation, Kalinga Maga invaded Polonnaruwa in 1215, 1215 AD. So this is the immediate reason for the fall of Polonnaruwa. Now, this is a very significant event that took place in the history of Sri Lanka. Okay. This is where now we are talking about Renaissance, right? Renaissance of Europe, why those countries are very developed and why we are not developed. We are not developed because of the fall of Polonnaruwa kingdom. If Polonnaruwa kingdom was there, it was again, after Anuradhapura, it was the powerful kingdom, you know, it ruled the whole country. And we could have held up for a very long time and we could have developed as a country. But because we had internal problems, invaders like Kalinga Maga were able to invade us in 1215 and destroy Polonnaruwa completely. And we could never establish a kingdom in Polonnaruwa again. All the kingdoms shifted to this area. That is what we are trying to talk in this unit. Okay. So this can be taken as a turning point in the history of Sri Lanka. Why we are here right now is because of this. Why this happened is because of the internal conflicts. So see what internal conflicts can do to a country. It can destroy a country. We are still struggling, you know. We can't even think of being a developed country yet, no? Still we can't think of something like that. We can't imagine being like England or Japan or some other country like that, right? It's like a dream. No? Why? Because of this. See? What happened in 1215? Invasion of Kalinga Maga. Okay. So then when Kalinga Maga invaded Polonnaruwa, all the people and the chieftain, the leaders, everybody had to shift to down south. Southern part of Sri Lanka. And establish their own kingdoms in different places after that, okay? Based on like security reasons and protection, you know, different places needs to be chosen for protection mainly. That is the reason, yeah.
Excuse me, sir. Sir.
Go ahead.
Sir, at what time the class end? There is only 1% battery in my tablet.
Oh, it's okay. All right. So 10:15, okay? 10:15. It's okay. This is being recorded, so don't worry about it. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
All right. So after that came, you know, like after the fall of Polonnaruwa came kingdoms like Dambadeniya, right, and Yapahuwa, Kurunagala, Gampola, Kote, and Kandy. Okay. Go to page number 101, guys. You can see there are many kingdoms after Anuradhapura and Polonnaruwa. So basically, there was a kingdom established in Dambadeniya after the fall of Polonnaruwa. We can easily guess that it is for protection, okay? Because Polonnaruwa was ruled by Kalinga Maga at that time. Okay. You know, the destruction caused by Kalinga Maga is so huge that people were kind of made like beggars. He destroyed everything he can destroy. Children were beaten. Look how Mahavamsa describes this. Okay. Everything happened because of what? Because there was no unity in the country. Kalinga Maga was able to attack and win the war or invade the countries because there were clashes between clans, different clans like Kalinga and Pandev clan in Polonnaruwa. Okay. That's the reason. So as you can see, we know that there are three main reasons for the downfall of Polonnaruwa. Three or four main reasons. Let's keep it three. One is weak rulers coming into power. The second one is the clashes between or the power struggle between the Kalinga and Pandyan clans. And the immediate reason is the invasion of Kalinga Maga. Okay. So let's take a little notes on this and conclude the session for today. And from next week, we're going to complete this lesson. We are going to talk about Dambadeniya and other kingdoms. Okay. And the importance of those kingdoms and the significant events that took place under those kingdoms. We are going to discuss those next week, right? Any questions from this part? We're going to take some notes and end the session for today. I will give you a tute for this anyway, but it's better to take some notes now. So what are the two ancient cities in the dry zone?
Anuradhapura and Polonnaruwa.
Exactly, yeah. So this is like, this is, when you read this, this might give you a glimpse of like pride. No, it's not something to be proud about, origin of new kingdoms. This is actually something to be very sad about because it's the decline of ancient cities. They were the two best cities. They were so developed and they were so advanced. Okay. Yes, we were talking about science and technology and everything, right? So Anuradhapura and Polonnaruwa, those two periods were at the pinnacle of all the science and technology in Sri Lanka. Okay. Yeah. So the hospitals, the toilets, the temples, the tanks, the canals, everything they built were of top notch. The constructions they did. Nothing like that happened during other kingdom periods. Okay. Yeah, nothing really happened. If you compare other kingdoms with Anuradhapura and Polonnaruwa, nothing comes close. Okay. Right. So, let's go to this one straight away. I will send you the tube, but I want you guys to write this one because it's very important. This can be a essay question in your O-level exam, okay? That is why I want you to write this. Okay, now I have a small activity for you guys. Take 5 to 10 minutes and let's end the session for today. Okay. So can you take a paper or you can use your book, no problem. Can you try to further explain these three? This can be a very serious question in your O levels, okay? Like 6 marks. Like a fourth part of, a written question, an essay question. Weak rulers come into power. After King Parakram Bahu and all the rulers, they couldn't rule for a very long time. They had very short ruling time periods. So, they couldn't bring political stability to the country. Only King Nishankamalla ruled for 9 years. That's also not a very long period. Again, power struggle between Pandya and Kalinga clans. Pandyan and Kalinga clans, they were trying to bring their own rulers to power. Okay. No need to write the stories. This king was brought or this queen was appointed by these people. No need to remember those, but you can just generally point out that this is what happened. So power struggle between Pandya and Kalinga clans. You know, both those clans claimed ownership to the throne and tried to bring their own people to the throne, okay, or to power. Economic deterioration, we can understand that because of those clashes taking place between the two clans, maintenance of tanks and everything were not done properly, okay, because of the political instability. So provincial ruling didn't take place properly, or provincial ruling was paralyzed, as they say. Nothing was organized properly. So this also led to the decline in agriculture. As a result, the economy of the country became paralyzed. Okay. So when the economy is paralyzed, remember this very well, guys. When the economy of a country is paralyzed, they can never face a sustained war. Even to face a strong war, if you want to fight with somebody, your economy has to be very strong. Okay? Otherwise, how can you supply? How can you, if you don't have enough food, if you don't have weapons, if you don't have enough money to pay the soldiers' salaries, how can you fight a war? Okay? Your economy is very important in fighting a war. Okay? You have to understand that very well. We had a war for 26 years in the country, you know, with the LTTE. What happened to our economy is history. We could never develop because of that war. So much money was spent on that war. That is one of the main reasons we are here today as well. Like, we could have become a little developed if there was no war. So I want you guys to write the answers and send me. Send me through WhatsApp. I want to see you writing. Okay, this is the most important part. I want to see if you can write essay questions. I mean, answers to essay questions and score marks. I want to correct them according to O-level standards. Okay. I want to give you some feedback. So send me those. Take a snap and send me. Okay. We'll continue the lesson next week. Any questions? We are open for any questions.
No questions.
Vetum, are you there? I think Vetum, you had a problem. Vetum had a problem. Who's had a problem with the, what do you call it, tab or something?
Yes.
Okay. You managed to connect a charge or something?
Yes.
Sajan, you okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Gaindu, you are so silent these days. Gaindu, all okay? Any questions?
Awesome.
Biandu, when is your exam, Buddha? When's your term test plan?
Sir, next month.
Okay. So we can very well finish this lesson next week and do some past papers also. And then we're going to start grade 11 stuff. Okay. After the week. Yeah, after 2 weeks. Grade 10, yeah. We are going back to basics. We are starting our lessons with map marking, Sri Lankan map marking, okay, grade 10. Grade 11, they also can join the lessons, no problem, okay? If you are free Friday morning, you can join grade 10 lessons. But yeah, next week will be a normal class like this, so combined class. So let's discuss about those things in detail next week, okay? And once you have completed this, the answers, please send me through WhatsApp, okay? If you have any questions, the group is open. You can post in the group anytime. I will be uploading the past papers and also the tutes in the group. Okay. If you have any questions, you can ask in the group as well. All right. Okay, then. I will see you guys next week. Hope you have a great week. Okay. Take care. Bye-bye. God bless you all.
Bless you, sir. Bye, sir.
Good night, sir. Good night, sir. Bye, sir. Thank you, sir. Bye. Have a nice day, sir.
See you. Bye-bye. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye.